Good morning. How's everyone doing tonight? Today, I was going to say tonight. Wow, this is exactly. This day is going by. How many are liking that coffee bar out there? You liking that? Amen. Get you awake for a service. We do. I don't preach a little 20-minute sermon like a lot of people. Amen. A lot of people come like twice a month because they figure they get three sermons in one sermon for the price of one. You know. That didn't make sense. But you know what I mean? I preach for a long time. So is everyone all right with that? You all right with that? I mean, amen. I hope you love, think about this, the Puritans who started this country, they would preach a minimum of an hour to 3 hours every Sunday. So think about that. If that, when we were solid, when we really knew the word back in the day when we started this country, how much more do we think we need that today? Amen? When we're bombarded with media, when we have all the craziness, liberal thinking that goes against the word, and we have our schools that kind of fight, Christian, have you noticed that a little bit? And kind of speak against it. We need to be, as the Bible says, the washing of the water of the word. Amen? I love what one pastor said, we need to be brainwashed. And not wash like, but brainwashed, wash out the junk, amen? And so we need that. And so I just want to say I am so thankful that you guys love the Word of God, amen? And that I very rarely do you guys fall asleep because I always say I'm like the blind discus thrower. I don't set any records, but I hopefully keep your attention, amen? So that's why every once in a while, hey, you know, just to make sure you're awake. How many like to hear a joke? Like to hear a joke? I'm going to try to beat Kevy. Kevy did a good joke the other day on Wednesday, so I'm going to try to beat that. So everyone will cheer real loud for me. All right. A country preacher decided to skip services one Sunday and head to the hills to do some bear hunting. As he rounded the corner of the trail, he ran head-on into a bear, sending him and his rifle tumbling down the mountainside. Before he knew it, his rifle went one way, he went the other. He landed on a rock and both of his legs were broken. That was the good news. The bad news is now he had a ferocious bear charging at him from a distance and he couldn't move because of his broken legs. So he prayed, "Oh Lord," the preacher prayed, "I am so sorry for skipping service today to go bear hunting. Please forgive me and grant me just one wish, oh Lord. Please make a Christian out of this bear that's coming to eat me right now." That very instant, the bear skidded to a halt, fell to his knees and put his paws together and began to pray right before the preacher's feet. He said, "Dear Lord, bless this food that I'm about to eat. Amen." All right. That's pretty good. If you have Bibles, please turn with me to Daniel chapter 9, verse 1. Daniel chapter 9, verse 1. And as I also said last week, then how many know that Daniel is not a book for wimps? I mean, it's an intense book. It's a deep book. And so, you know, if you don't get it, just know this, like we said last week, that the book of Daniel is to prepare you to know that the Lord is coming back, to prepare you. Prophecy is not to scare you, but it's to prepare you to live right, to be ready for the Lord's return. Because how many know nothing needs to happen for the Lord to return? Amen? Nothing, nothing, nothing with Israel, nothing needs to happen. The Lord could come back right now. And we need to live like that. And how many know this? If you're one of those people that are kind of cynical, yeah, they've been saying that for years. Chuck Smith said that 50 years ago. How many know we know for sure the Lord is coming back sooner today than he was 50 years ago? And we need to be ready. And the Bible says that when we think it's not going to happen, that's when it's going to happen. And guess what? A lot of people don't think it's going to happen. So know that it is ready to happen. And I believe that. When you see the craziness of our world, amen? To see that we're arguing about a guy who thinks he's a girl going into a girl's bathroom. Amen? Is anyone awake out there? Or is that too PC? Right? I love that. How, you know, that's why this is getting weird, because we can just sit there. What do you think about that? We need to say, hey, remember there used to be a song, "Dude Looks Like a Lady," right? We used to sing about that. That was weird. But now we can't say anything, can we? But how we know we should be able to speak the truth in love and say, you know what? A guy's a guy and a girl's a girl. Amen? And you need to go to the right bathroom. Amen? I don't know if you heard it. General Boykin. Does anyone know General Boykin? He's a godly. He's a guy who started the Delta Force. And we got to meet him. And he got in trouble because I guess at a baccalaureate or somewhere, he said at a college, he said, well, if any guy who thinks he's a girl comes into my daughter's bathroom, restroom, he says, you won't have to worry about getting a sex change. He was not asked to come back and speak there anymore. But they apologized, and now he's going to be able to come back. But anyway, Daniel chapter 9, verse 1. The title of today's message is Daniel Shows Us How to Pray. Daniel shows us how to pray. We're going to see in chapter 9 here that the most important thing that we can do in the service to our God and our King is to become men and women of prayer. And I don't know about you, but have you noticed that prayer is just the easiest thing to do in this busy day, isn't it? Right? Does anyone here want to have the guts to say, you pray too much? Right? I think all of us, if I asked you, would say, I don't do as well as I should. Can anyone raise your hand so everyone see? All right, okay. I mean, all of us need to pray more. And I don't know about you, I believe every one of us we hear that loves God would say, I want to pray more. I know I should pray more. But how many know? It's like John Lennon said, life is what happens to you when you're making other plans. And I want to tell you this, you've got to plan to pray. Because if you don't plan to pray, it's not going to happen. Unless you're like that guy with the bear, then you'll pray. Amen? But how many know we should be praying before we're in the emergency room, before the bear is charging us? We should be praying because, how many know, this world has got the bear trying to gulp it, and it's called Satan. And we need to be praying. We need to be interceding and crying out for that. So we need to pray. Here in chapter 9, we'll see a prayer of Daniel that the Holy Spirit has preserved for us to study today, along with those great prayers recorded in Ezra 9 and Nehemiah 9. This is one of the three great prayers of the Old Testament. We're going to study that right now. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this day. And thank you for everyone here. I ask, oh God, that right now, Lord, as my week's been real busy and my mind just seems like it's everywhere right now, I pray that you would help me to focus. Help everyone here to focus, no matter what. Even if they have a broken pipe at home or something's not working right or their car had a flat tire, I ask that right now we'd be able to just put those cares and worries away and that you would just give us a time right now to just focus on you, to hear you, Lord. You've spoken to us through worship. You've ministered to us. But now we ask that you would speak to us through your word. Your word is blessed, but we pray right now. I pray for everyone hearing, whether it be here or in the lobby or on the internet. I ask that you would open their ears and open their minds to hear what your Spirit is saying to them, the church. And Father, I pray for myself that, Lord, as I said, your word does not need to be blessed. It's blessed. But I ask that you would bless me to rightfully divide your word, to rightly interpret your word. That I wouldn't add to it, Father, but I also wouldn't take away. That I wouldn't be PC, but I instead would be JC, Jesus correct. And I'd preach the whole counsel of God with boldness, but yet with love and with mercy. So, Father, speak, have your way, and minister to us. And everyone agreed, said aloud, amen. Amen. All right. Verse 1 of Daniel chapter 9. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, something like that, and the lineage of the Medes, who is made king over the realm of the Chaldeans. Verse 2, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by the books the number of years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in desolations of Jerusalem. Although Daniel was a seer and this great prophet, he was still a student of the word. Although he was a prophet, he was still someone who loved to learn. How many know we should always love to learn the word of God? We should be people who love the word of God. I tell you, the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The Bible says that he puts his name, his word above his name. We should love his word. The Bible says that heaven and earth shall pass away, but his word shall endure forever. How many like that? There's not going to be a new word in heaven, a new revised word. What you learn here is going to be for all eternity, and I love that. I love the consistency, the solidness of the word of God. But we need to learn. We need to love to learn. That is what he was one who read the word regularly. Daniel studied it carefully. Now hear this. If Daniel was one who gives, was given to reading and researching and studying the scriptures, then how much more do you and I need to do the same? Amen? Besides prayer, I think some of us can say, some of us only read our Bibles on Sunday right now and sometimes on Wednesday. But how many know we need to be in the Word throughout the day? We need to, remember it says that I am the bread of life. His Word is life. His Spirit is that water that we will never thirst again. And we need that. I don't know about you, but does anyone ever wake up just stressed out? One of you? Okay. But we wake up, right? And you don't even know why you're stressed. You just know you're stressed. But I want to tell you this is perfect peace, the Bible says, perfect peace have those whose hearts are stayed on thee. When our heart is on the Lord, we have peace. When our heart isn't on the Lord, when we're busy doing a bunch of stuff, how many know that? We always say that lie, don't we? I'm going to get this and this done, then I'll seek the Lord. Don't we? But how many know we get so stressed out and then we're saying, Lord, I'm so stressed, I can't seek you right now. But how many know the Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, live right with him, and then all these things shall be added unto you. We need to believe that, guys. It's either true or it's not true. And I want to tell you, the world is going to do its best to distract you. Look over here, do this. I was reading my Bible, and I have a ceiling fan just yesterday, and I was reading my Bible, and have you ever had a ceiling fan that clicks, kick, 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 kick? When you're an ADD boy like me, I'm just like, you know, I'm just like, I can't stop. And so I'm messing with my fan like this, and I tweaked it too hard. I make it not work now. I popped the wires, I think, you know. And so I'm going, okay, should I read or fix the wire? And the Lord's like, read. You know, but okay, you know what I mean? It was just so hard. Does anyone relate to that kind of stuff? Do you ever notice when you pray and read the Word, you become the most responsible person in the world? I got to paint the house. I got to do this. I got to do this. Now, when you watch TV, as I say, you never worry about it, right? You never go, I've got so much to do. Maybe women do, but us guys go, whatever, right? But when we read the Bible, all of a sudden, every care, every worry is on the top of our mind. I'll tell you this. Here's the answer, except for ceiling fans. You put a pad and paper by you and write down what you need to do and then just put it to the side and go back on with praying and reading the Word. Amen? But I want to tell you this, guys. Here's the little trick I've seen. When I will put the Lord first, the clock seems to go a lot slower. But if I put all my things to do first and then say, God, you'll get whatever's left over, how many know the clock just spins? All of a sudden, I look at the clock, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I'm like, I didn't even get anything done. So honor the Lord. The Bible says the Lord honors those who honor him. And that's all free right there. All right, here it is. Daniel comes to chapter 25 of Jeremiah, chapter 25, Jeremiah, verse 12. And he sees that Jeremiah foretold that King Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians would carry his Jewish people into captivity. Now, why did God allow this? Why did he allow the captivity? Well, if you were here at the beginning of Daniel, you know he allowed it because they were idolatrous. And what does idolatry mean? It means they put other things before God. They had other gods. They put other things before God. And because of that, God allowed them to enter into captivity. How many know, as I said last week, America is heading towards that? How many know that when the Bible is on the top 10 list of forbidden works in the schools and in our public libraries, how many know that probably hurts the heart of God? And when the Quran is way down the list, the Quran, we're people that want to hurt us, and that's not even at all a threat at all. But the Bible, which kind of founded this country, a lot of our laws, you go through Washington, look at how much scripture is all over the place, and yet that's a scary book. I know, guys, we have to not be so PC, but we need to be JC. We need to be worried about hurting God. Amen? Offending God, right? We need to be worried. That's what the Bible says. The fear of the Lord was not in them. How many know? We got to quit being worried about offending men and more worried about offending God. Amen? 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 Because the Bible says, Jesus said, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father in heaven. But if you acknowledge me before men, I'll acknowledge you before my Father in heaven when he comes in glory with all his heavenly angels. How many know? I want God to acknowledge me. And that means I got to be willing to acknowledge him when it's not always popular. And how many know this is not a popular time to acknowledge the truths of God? But how many know when you are standing before God in heaven, you're going to be real glad you did. You're not going to be, but Lord, there's not going to be any buts. It'll be you chose to fear man more than you chose to fear me. And I don't want any one of you to hear that or myself to hear that. They had ignored God's word continually, specifically, hear this, in the Sabbath year rest. They forgot, they had idolatry, but they also forgot to obey the Sabbath year rest. You see, according to Leviticus 25, verse 2, every 7 years, God's people were to do no plowing or tilling of the ground. The land was to rest. Now, we know agriculturally and scientifically this is important, but they didn't know that back then. We know that if you keep going too hard on the land, you can ruin the topsoil and it'll become a dust bowl, and you need to let it replenish, and you put fertilizer in it and kind of strengthen it. But I found this out. This is kind of interesting. I was found this out when I went to Mount Vernon, that tobacco, if you grow tobacco, it's really hard on the soil. Isn't that amazing? Tobacco is not good for you, but it's also very hard on the soil. It crushes it. So George Washington wouldn't grow tobacco because he said it was too hard on his land. So they were to give the land rest. But they, now hear this, they didn't know that it was good to give rest. They just took it by faith because that's what the Bible said. But hear this, on the sixth year, the Lord would give them twice as much grain in order to see them through the seventh year. Now, I don't know about you, I would kind of dig that, wouldn't you, as a farmer? I get to relax for 1 year. But they said, oh no, we're going to keep working. Isn't that amazing? When God tells us to do something, we don't do it. Now, some of you are going to go, yeah, I can't believe that. Why wouldn't they rest? But how many know we do the same thing, don't we? The Bible says, honor him with his first fruits, give 10% to him, tithe. I know it's your favorite topic, isn't it? Tithe, give 10% off the top, honor the Lord, put it first. And guess what? He promises you'll be able to do more with 90% than you can do with your full 100. But yet people say, oh, no, Lord. I got to pay all my bills first, and whatever's yours, whatever's left over is yours. I heard one person say it this way, I throw my money in the air, and whatever stays is God's, and whatever falls is mine. No one's going to laugh? No. Okay. But I'm telling you this, either God's word is true or it's not. And we can look at them and say, yeah, why wouldn't you obey God? God says 1 year, I would love to have a break. Wouldn't you love that? And God provided twice as much grain on the sixth year for the seventh year so they didn't have to work. But yet they kind of got greedy and said, hey, if he'll bless us twice as much, what will happen if we have one extra year? We've got to trust God. We've got to be people who trust God with our finances and trust his word. And how many know this? Even us, even though we have a lot more knowledge today than they had in some ways, they had to just take this by faith. But for 490 years, they ignored this Sabbath rest, this commandment to give the land one rest every seventh year. In other words, the land missed out on, hear this, for 490 years, which is seven into it, is 70 years. 70 years into 490, 70 years they missed of rest. Therefore, the Lord told Jeremiah that his people would be carried away in captivity for 70 years. And while they were gone, the land would indeed rest. Now, hear this, guys. This is kind of interesting to me that, you know, I don't think too many of us are tree huggers out there. I'm from Oregon, so I can mock them. I can tease them, you know, Birkenstocks and white socks and, you know, hey. But, but hear this. God does really care about the environment. Amen? He does. And we're to be good stewards of the environment. We're to, you know, we're not to love Mother Earth because it's not our mother. It's a creation. It's not a living being like, oh, Mother Earth, like she's a person, but we are to care about the environment. We are to be, as the Bible says, good stewards, which means a servant manager. We're to manage the earth that God has given us. But here's where it gets a little weird. Here's the key. We're to care about the land and the environment, but we're not to worship it. Amen? We're not to worship Mother Earth. You know, hear people say, they're raping our Mother Earth. They're raping her. And I will not stand for this. You know, my earth. You know, I shared the gospel with some guy, and he shared global warming with me. It was his gospel. And I said, but it's been getting warm and hot. Do you remember how many old people like me? I'm 50 years old, 53. How many remember the ice age threat when we were kids? Can we pick a calamity and stick with it? Ice age, now we're extreme heat. I mean, come on, it's just crazy. But, you know, it's been going up and down, up and down. But hear this, we are to take care of God's creation, but not worship it. Here it is, Romans 1:25 says this, they traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshiped and served the things God created, or the creation, instead of the creator himself. How many know that's the problem?
If you really love the world, you should love its creator, God. So if you're a true tree hugger out there, you should not be hugging the tree, but hugging God who created the tree that you love.
Amen.
Amen? You guys just aren't going to talk today, are you? You're just like, nope.
It's summertime. I'm hot. I'm not going to talk.
Right. Now, for 70 years, the 70 years is up. So what did Daniel do? Jeremiah's writings didn't simply stimulate his curiosity, but they moved him to hear this activity. That's always the purpose of prophecy. After reading Jeremiah's prophecy, Daniel was prompted, hear this, to pray. And I'll tell you this, when you read the Word of God, it should prompt you to pray. When you watch Fox News or watch, I don't know what you watch, you should be prompted to pray, not get angry and throw things at your TV. You should pray because it's getting crazy out there. And how many know getting angry does not help you? The Bible says the anger of man does not fulfill or satisfy the righteousness of God. We need to be angry, but sin not. Be angry and do something about it and pray. And that's what we should be doing. Many times people don't pray because they don't know. They haven't been studying or meditating on the Word of God. When they try to pray, they don't know what to talk about. I have news for you guys. God is a great conversationalist. And He initiates the conversation to us through His Holy Word. That's why reading the Bible is so important and studying it is so essential. As I read the Word, I discover things that God likes to talk about in prayer. How many know this? You will learn what God... How many know it's good to know what God wants to hear in prayer? Because the Bible says in James, you have not because you ask not. But when you ask, you don't receive because you ask with wrong motives. So how many know it's good to know the right motives? It's good to know what touches the heart of God and what doesn't touch the heart of God. It's good to know. I don't know about you, but we don't pray that much, so we better be good at the times we do pray. Amen? We better know how to pray right, and so the way we know that is through studying the Word of God. Studying the Word of God. It's essential. 1 John 5:14 says this, "Now this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us." Do you realize that? Do you hear that? So that means every time you and I pray and we don't get an answer, what's that saying? We're asking for the wrong thing. Because Jesus said through John, He said, if we ask according to the Father's will, it will be done. But if I ask, Lord, make me better than everyone in this room, I know that's not God's highest priority for me to be better than you. But if I say, Lord, help me to be the servant of your people, to be the greatest servant to your people and just love them like you do, how many know that's a prayer God will answer, right? And so we need to know how to pray. We need to know what God wants us to ask Him for. Verse 3 of Daniel 9, "Then I set my face towards the Lord God to make requests by prayer, supplications with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes." After he was moved by the Word of God to pray, we now see the preparation for prayer. Daniel set his face, which speaks of determination. How many know you've got to determine to pray? If you say this, oh Lord, if you want me to pray tomorrow, wake me up early. How many know you will hear that alarm and just go, you know, this is the cold and flu season, even if it's summer. You'll make an excuse, oh, I really need my sleep. Do you know this? Hear this, guys. I always love, there would be these guys at church that would be so spiritual and tell me, Craig, you need to do this, and we don't do this, you need to do this. We do a Wednesday night service. I say, oh, I can't make it to Wednesday night service. Why can't you make it Wednesday night service? Because I need my rest. If I go to Wednesday night service, I'll only get 7 hours sleep. Do you know Paul and Jesus a lot of times would pray all the way through the night and still go to work and do stuff? I'll take the silence of... As you know what I'm talking about. I mean, we can live on 7 hours sleep. You know that, right? I think chemically we only need about 3 hours. But how many know? 7 hours, they say, to be healthy, you need about seven. You know, I get like four. And that's why I'm, you know, like this all the time. You know, I don't know who I am. But how many know? We get, most of us get plenty of sleep. And we can sacrifice to pray. Amen? Yeah. We can sacrifice once in a while. We can make it to Wednesday night service. I guess we don't want to. But hear this. Daniel set his face, which speaks of determination. You know, I'll tell you this real quick. I'll never forget, I was just sitting there, and a lot of times we pray on Friday nights for the service, but then the Lord said to me, you need to pray before the service. I pray on my own, but pray with the people, pray with the leadership. And so I, but Lord, I got to get up earlier. I mean, I got to even get up earlier than I'm already getting up, and I need my sleep because I don't sleep much on Sunday nights or Saturday nights. And so I was like, Lord. And the Lord goes, hey, you asked me what to do. I told you. And how many know? I'm doing that because I believe it's important. Amen. And I believe that God, you know, it's like, I think it was Martin Luther, the great reformer, said, God can do more with our lives with 1 second of prayer than we can do in a whole lifetime. And I want us to believe that. I know we'll say amen to it, but we don't say really amen in our hearts because we don't do it. If we only knew, I guarantee you, when you and I go to heaven, we're going to be so regretful that we didn't spend more time with God in prayer. Because prayer is so powerful. Prayer can do what you could never do in your own strength. Amen? Prayer can move heaven and earth, and we want that. Amen? We need to see this country grow. How many know? We need to pray for our country. We can't just let it happen. We need to be crying out that, Lord, turn America back to you. Sackcloth here speaks to, hear this, a hairy garment. Camel's hair usually turned inside out so its bristles would come continually rub against one's skin. So what was Daniel doing by doing this? I don't know. He just liked to be irritated. No, it's to keep him kind of awake and keep him alert. How many know that? You'll keep alert when you wear a camel skin. Have you ever had a wool blanket? You ever slept with a wool blanket? I never forget. We did like some camping out thing with some camp, and they didn't have enough blankets, and so I got a wool blanket. That will keep you up. You know what I'm talking about? Those old, heavy-duty wool blankets. But how many know? It's kind of good because does everyone notice when you pray sometimes, do you ever like go into la-la land? Yeah, so what I do in prayer is I usually walk, right? If I sit on my couch, I'll be like, especially my lazy boy, I'm like, oh, I mean, I get good rest in the Lord, but not much prayer. And so I will walk when I pray. And then another thing I got, here's from the Jewish people, I got this. You ever been to Israel, the Western Wall, you'll see them going like this. And so I kind of got this. You know, I do a little, I don't know what it is, like a little peck. I think I'm a woodpecker or something. But I just kind of go like this. And you watch me, if you watch me pray, hopefully you shouldn't be. But if I pray, I'll be doing this sometimes because it keeps me up. Because sometimes if I get too still, I will. I did that once. We had a prayer at the ranch. And there was this lady and she prayed. And she'd go, Lord, thank you so much. She had this monotone voice. And I just ended up, I took some allergy medicine. Next thing I know, I'm going. And if you're like, Craig, Pastor Craig, and I was out. It was bad. And I've learned I need to, you know, move, you know. So, I mean, it's crazy. So I think that's what that is to keep him moving and keep him focused on the Lord. And it's also showing that he's serious in seeking God. Fasting, hear this, fasting, he talks about, is a way we can seek the Lord in seriousness. Fasting is an important tool in the Christian arsenal, both in doing battle with the enemy and in seeking our Father's will and seeking his blessings. All day long, we hear this, are bombarded with advertising, internet, smartphones. What's the little thing, the music thing? I was going to say a Walkman. That's how old I am. What do you call your little iPod, you know, and we have all kinds of noise just barking us. Have you ever watched, I used to think that watching, did you ever watch guys watch TV? Now you see people with their phones. It's everyone. I love this little thing my wife sent me. It says, Grandma could die and no one would notice. It shows that everyone's visiting Grandma and they're looking at their phone and Grandma's just sitting there not knowing what to do. Isn't that crazy? That's how we are. I mean, it's like, now I'm not saying get rid of your smartphone. I'm just saying maybe fast your smartphone a little bit. I'll tell you, I mean, you know, that smartphone is, it can really help you, but it can really be a tool of the enemy to distract you. And we need to be careful with it because we need to focus on the Lord. Not only are our senses bombarded, but our stomachs are constantly craving certain kinds of foods. We're stuffing ourselves with this and that and the other. Think about that. When you were in the world, what did you do? Let's go have a beer. Now what do you say after church? Let's go eat, right? That's all we do is eat. You know, the world has beer bellies. We have bellies just from eating food, right? No one's going to laugh. Okay, all right. But we like to eat. That's what we do. We eat. Fasting is a practical way of saying, I'm not going to continue showering myself with physical sensations, with stimuli. I'm going to focus on the Lord. And hear this, guys. How many know we spend, if you fast, has anyone fasted here? You ever fasted? Okay. Now you lost your reward. No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm just teasing. But here it is. Fasting is you don't realize how much your life revolves around eating food. Do you realize that? I mean, you spend hours eating food. Everything is preparation of food, getting food, unless you go to fast food all the time. It takes you at least, probably all you're eating is an hour. So if you say, oh, God, I don't have time to pray, then fast and you'll have time to pray. You have at least an hour. I bet you if you take breakfast, lunch, and dinner, you have at least an hour, if not a couple hours, especially if you cook really good meals like my wife does, you'll have hours to pray. So fasting can be really good in giving you time. I'm going to slow my life down. Psychologically, you actually become clearer thinker when you're fasting. Tests confirm this. Because why? When you eat, all your blood goes to your stomach. That's why I don't eat before I speak, because I need all the blood I can get to my head, right? I need to be focused. If you speak, you should never eat before you speak because the blood goes there. So it makes you a clearer thinker. When you're fasting, tests confirm also that it's good for you physically, that it helps purge your body. My wife's like getting into fasting because she had breast cancer. Fasting purges your body from toxins. That's why if you fast, just if you drink water, you'll find your tongue gets kind of like this filmy stuff on it, and that's because all the toxins are kind of coming out of your body. Fasting is not a way to score points with the Lord, but it's an avenue to deny your flesh physically in order to concentrate on the spiritual realm. And hear this real quick. If you can say no to the natural desires for your stomach, then how many know, guys, that when all of a sudden a pretty girl walks by or something pops on your net, you'll be able to have the discipline to say no to that fleshly desire. Amen? It's a spiritual discipline. People say, oh, no. Yes, it is. Because it's a natural desire to eat, and also it's a natural desire, the sexual desires from God, but you'll learn to keep it within marriage. Amen? If you're single, you won't fornicate, and if you're married, you won't commit adultery. Because why? You've learned to discipline your flesh to say, I rule over my flesh, not my flesh rules over me. Amen? The spirit in me rules over it. And that's what fasting does too, is it says, hey, I will take charge of my body, not my body, everything at once. Oh, we just go there. No, I will walk by the spirit. I will walk in the spirit of self-control. Fasting is not meant to prove, as I said, something to God, but is simply place ourselves in a position where we can hear him more clearly. As a teenager, Daniel saw how important fasting was. But now hear this. As an around 86 to 90-year-old guy, he's still fasting. I hear old people, oh, I can't fast. Now, hear me, if you're taking lots of medicine, I get it. You gotta eat to take your medicine. But I mean, no, fasting, if Daniel can do it at 86, how many know some of us can do it? And hear this too. You don't have to eat, just do water. You can do vegetables. You can do juice fast. You can do all kinds of fasts. As long as it's something where you're saying, God, I'm doing this to dedicate myself to seek you and to prayer. That's all God sees. Maybe you can just say, I'm not going to eat sweets. But just something once in a while. And usually see it as a time, like I saw when my wife was diagnosed with cancer. I fasted. I cried out to God because I wanted to focus on that and just ask God to really heal her and touch her body. And I believe God has. Amen? God is good. And so we need to do that. Fast. Cry out. Verse 4 of Daniel. And I prayed to the Lord, my God, and made confession and said, O Lord, great and awesome God who keeps his covenant and mercy with those who love him and those who keep his commandments. After the prompting from the word, after his preparation of fasting and sackcloth, here we are. We see the kind of Daniel's introduction to prayer. And here it is. He says he's remembering who he's talking to. The Bible says, hear this, we're to enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. I want to tell you this, guys. I encourage you, some of you guys come in really late. We need to hit the ground running, amen? I want to tell you, I used to be a good Baptist boy. Any Baptists out there? Any old Baptists? One, two, okay, I used to be a Baptist boy. And I tell you, worship was not important to me at all. Worship was for girls, sissies. But I saw just the word was important. And I'd always come in late. But I want to tell you this, enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts of praise. We should hit the ground running. God says he inhabits the praises of his people. How many know praise is what we're going to be doing in heaven? You might want to get good at it here. And so I encourage you to come in. Don't come in 10 minutes late. And here's another thing. Don't come in all burdened down from the week when you didn't pray or read and didn't obey. And don't spend 10 minutes saying, oh, God, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Oh, God, I'm sorry. Do that on the way to church. And try not to fight with your husband or wife on the way to church. Amen? Some of the best fights my wife and I have ever had is on the way to church. I mean, no, the devil works real hard to do that. But we need to be careful because why? We want to hit the ground praising God. We want to enter his gates. You should enter those doors. You should enter the gates of this place just thanking him. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. You should hit the ground praising God because I want to tell you this. We need the favor of God. We need to let God know how much we love him. There's so many people offending him in this country. We need to be the remnant that says, God, we love you even if a majority does not love you. And how many tell? No, it takes the remnant. It doesn't mean a huge group. Remember this? Remember when the angel of the Lord was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah? And Abraham said, what if there's a 50 people? And what if there's 10? He went down to 10, I believe. But most scholars said that he would have not destroyed it for one righteous man or woman. How many know? Look at this. What is this? 80 people? Maybe 85? If we will seek the Lord, if we will cry out, how many know we can restrain the hand of God's judgment on this country? And I hope you care about your grandkids. I hope you care, even if you don't have kids, care about your cousins and nephews. Care about this. Because guess what, guys? We always talk about the deficit and all that. But how many know? We're also giving them a sin. The real issue is not our financial issue. The real issue is a deficit with God. Amen? Our financial deficit is because we've forsaken God. If we get God back as number one in this country, how many know our financial worries will go away too?
Amen.
Amen? That's easy to fix, but we need to put God first and not, as I said, what does the Bible say? Don't seek the deficit first. Seek first him and his kingdom, and then he'll make all these other things work together for good, right? He'll bless them. Amen? After prompting, we see that we're to enter his courts because as we reflect on the greatness of God, hear this, as we worship him, the problems that seem so big to us will shrink radically. I encourage you to spend time starting your day in prayer by reflecting upon and remembering the greatness, the goodness of God. After all, hear this, guys, hear this. Isaiah 48:13 says this, "My hand also has laid the foundation of the earth, and my right hand has spanned the heavens." That means, hear this, God spans his hand from his thumb to his pinky. He spans the whole universe. Light years away, he spans in his hand. You remember those, I got the whole world in my hand? Not my hands, my hand. He's got the whole world right there. That's how big your God is. That's how awesome he is. And when you read his word and know that, how many know your little problems, even though they seem insurmountable, even though they seem there's no fix, how many know when you see how big God is, you go, you know what, I think a big God can take care of my little problems. But if you just focus on life and you just focus on what's in front of you, how many know the devil wants to keep you on the treadmill, running, to where you don't see, all you see is your problems. But how many know you need to stop, collaborate, and listen. No, okay. You need to stop and say, God, I'm going to put you first, and I'm going to see that you're bigger than all of the problems of this country, of this world, of my life. You know, I'm dealing with my house. Does anyone ever stress out about their house? Oh, my goodness, roof problems, Vega problems. Does anyone have Vegas on their house? My goodness, whoever invented Vegas, I would like to slap them. I mean, they are just problems. But anyways, I'm stressing out about that. So if anyone wants to serve God by fixing my Vegas, no, I'm kidding. I'm just teasing. But we need to see that. After all, if he spans the universe in hands, he's got us covered. Verse 5 of Daniel 9. We have sinned and committed iniquity. Now hear this, guys. Listen as we read this. How many times he says we and how many times he says us. Daniel doesn't go, you guys. And Daniel, as we're going to see in a moment, could say you guys, you guys, you guys. He says we guys, we. Hear that. We, verse 5, have sinned and committed iniquity. We have done wickedly and rebelled even by departing from your precepts and your judgments. Verse 6, neither have we heeded your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings and our princes, to our fathers and all the people of the land. Verse 7, O Lord, righteousness belongs to you, but to us shame of face, or shame, as it is this day, to the men of Judah, to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, in all Israel, those near and those far off, in all the countries to which you have driven them, because of the unfaithfulness which they have committed against you. Verse 8, O Lord, to us belongs shame of face, to our kings, our princes, our fathers, because we have sinned against you. Verse 9, to the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, though we have rebelled against him. Verse 10, we have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws, which he set before us by his servants, the prophets. Verse 11, yes, all Israel has transgressed. Notice he says all Israel has transgressed your law and has departed so not to obey your voice. Notice too, he says your voice. We're required by God to hear the voice of God. Do you hear that? Now you can say, oh, that's Old Testament. We should hear it more. Remember Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and will not listen to another. God requires you and I to spend enough time to hear and know his voice so we know when he says don't do that, or we know when he says do something. Amen? Hear that. That not obey his voice. Therefore, the curse and the oath written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, has been poured out on us because we have sinned. We, again, have sinned against him. Verse 12, and he has confirmed his words, which he spoke against us and against our judges who judge us by bringing upon us great disaster, 7 years of captivity. For under the whole heaven, such has never been done as what has been done to Jerusalem, devastated. Verse 13, as it is written in the law of Moses, all this disaster has come upon us, yet we have not made our prayer before the Lord our God. They didn't pray even though it was going on. That we might turn from our iniquities and understand your truth. Verse 14, therefore the Lord has kept the disaster in mind and brought it upon us. Meaning he didn't stop it because they didn't pray and ask. For the Lord our God is righteous in all the works which he does, though we have not obeyed his voice. Verse 15, and now, O Lord our God, we brought your people, who brought your people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand and made yourself a name as it is this day. Hear this, we have sinned, we have done wickedly. I want to just say this real quick. I don't know what it is about us that has such a hard time hearing that. Can everyone raise their hand that you're a sinner? But isn't it amazing how it's such a downer to us to admit what this prayer just said? It's so hard for us to admit. We admit it, we go, yeah, but we don't want to talk about it. But I want to tell you this, hopefully you'll see that it's important to talk about it. Amen. Because if we don't talk about it and deal with it, it's going to deal with us. Amen. Ignoring it does not make it go away. But dealing with it in the right way will hopefully fix it. Amen? Amen. And I pray we all want to fix, because we all admit we're sinners, but I hope we realize that we need to, again, know the word and know how God wants us to deal with our sin. Amen. Here it is. Here we see the major portion of Daniel's prayer is a prayer of what? Repentance. We have sinned. Us, we. He didn't say you. He says us, me. He realized the problem of Israel was that they were experiencing was not because God was cruel or he didn't care, but because they were sinful. What does sin mean? They missed the mark. They didn't do it God's way. They did it their way. Hear this. When judgments of God come down during the great tribulation period, the saints and the angels and the elders in heaven will say, hear this, Revelation 19:2, they'll say this, righteous and true are your judgments, O Lord. Do you hear that? They'll say, when the world is getting shredded by the enemy and by God's wrath being poured out on it, they'll say, righteous and true are your judgments, O God. Not a single one will say, hey, God, come on, that's not fair. You're being mean. Stop. All of them will say, the world has rejected you. The world has rejected your son. Now your judgments, righteous and true, are your judgments, O God. We have to see that. We have to see that God is a God of great love and mercy. Amen. But hear this. Do you remember what it says in Revelation 6 at the end? It says, why will God pour out his wrath against this world? It won't be because of its sin. The main sin that he'll pour out his wrath is because this, it says, that he'll pour out his wrath against a world that has rejected the Lamb of God. Do you understand that? He'll pour out his wrath for a world that has rejected his provision for sin, the cross, Jesus, and rejected and said, I don't care. And then he'll say, okay, you don't care? Then I will judge you without Jesus. And guess what? We all lose if we don't have Jesus. So that's why it's important to tell people. That's why it's important not to be PC, but to be JC, because the Bible says he who has a son has what? Life. And he who does not have the son does what? not have life, death. And wrath will be poured out on a nation and a country and a world that rejects the provision for sin, Jesus. How many know sin has been dealt with? Isn't that good news? The only reason people get judged is because they rejected Jesus. How many people you hear, I'm a good person? How many know that would take God about a 1 millisecond to say, no, you're not? How many of you could tell most people that say that to you, no, you're not, I know you're a jerk, seriously. Amen? You tell me one person, you go, no, you really are, you can usually, right? Can't you say with your coworkers, no, dude, I saw you, that lady was waiting for the parking spot and you whipped in, I saw it, you're a jerk, you know? Just not going to laugh today, are you? That's nice. Make me feel uncomfortable. Okay, but here it is. They will say, they won't say, what are you doing, O Lord? They'll say, what your righteous, just, righteous and true are your judgments. So hear this, if we desire to be mature saints in the Lord, then one of the keys is to recognize that what God does is right all the time. His judgments are righteous and true are your judgments, God. What he does is right. If you ever doubt, hear this. What does Jesus say? You being evil, give your children good gifts. How much more your Heavenly Father? So guess what, guys? If you ever think you're indicting God, guess what? You're evil, you know? Because think about it. If you say, well, my God would never judge. Okay, well then let me stab your mom in the head and see if you want any justice for that. God is a God who says what? I'm a loving God. But I'm also a just God, and I will pour out wrath, and I will pour out judgment on those who reject my provision for sin. How many know this isn't preached in many churches today? I can tell your faces. Oh, wow. How many know this is true? This is true, amen? Amen, yeah, clap it up. God's good word is good. You're getting the whole counsel of God. You're getting new improved cheer, everything, okay? The reason that you and I, the reason that they were in the mess they were in is because of their sinfulness, because of the rejecting of God and his ways. And hear this, guys. This is where it hits home. You're going to love me for this. The reason that our country is in the mess it's in is because of our sins. Our sins, not their sins. Our sins. I had someone in our church, they're no longer here. We kicked them out. Okay. But they said to me, Craig, you sure preach a lot about sin. You talk to us like we're sinners. What are you doing? And I said, our church has sin. Really? Your church? And then it was kind of like, so you're a bad pastor. You have sinful people in your church? I'm going, I think you have the sin of pride. Right? Self-righteousness. But she was going, oh, you have sin? Oh, good. Oh, that's sick. Sicko. You know? Do you remember the story? Do you remember the story about the Pharisee coming to pray at the temple body? He goes, oh, Lord, thank you. I'm not like those people. I'm not a sinner. Thank you that I fast, and I fast twice a week, and I tithe, and I help out with gospel rescue mission. I do everything. And then the little tax collector, the sinner, gets up there and can't even look up. He beats his chest and said, Lord, have mercy on a sinner like me. And what did Jesus say? Who left justified? The sinner. The person who acknowledged, I'm not all that. Now hear this, guys. Don't go the other way. Hey, as long as I just beat my chest, I'm a loser. No, live right. But be humble that even if you're doing better than you've ever done, you still got issues. Amen? You still have areas. Just ask your husband. Or your wife, right? Ask your wife, your husband, definitely ask your wife. You know, you'll know. But be humble. Don't ever get to the place where you're like, I don't sin. I had a guy seriously say that to me. It's so funny. Oh, God. I'm trying to be short, but I can't help it. There's too many stories. But this guy, I was up in Pine Top, and I'm ministering. This old guy comes up to me and goes, that was a pretty good sermon, boy. And I go, well, thank you. And he goes, yeah, you talked about sin, but, you know, I haven't sinned in 18 years. I thought he was messing with me. I go, so I've been, I'm a little smart aleck, and people used to laugh at me, but not anymore. But anyways, but I said to him, I said, you must be pretty proud of that. He goes, you're darn right I am. Ding, 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 you know, pride, right? But I didn't have the heart to tell him that. I just walked away kind of going, but anyway. All the mess that our sin brings into our lives is not God's fault. Because he's always righteous and true are his judgments. He's right in all he does. He's right in how he treats us. Proverbs 19:3 says this, and I know this is heavy stuff, but just deal with it. It says this, it's a man's own folly or foolishness that ruins his life, yet his heart rages against the Lord. Isn't that amazing? Isn't it amazing that here we'll vote to have prayer out of schools, we'll vote to have Bible out of schools, we'll vote to have anything Christian out of schools, we won't let any Christian plays, we won't let any Christian singing of any Christmas songs in schools. But then when there's a shooting in school, what is the first thing people say who got God out of schools? They say, how could a loving God allow this? Well, the answer is you kicked him out. And what you're experiencing is the enemy. You're experiencing a vacuum, and guess who's filling it? The enemy. Isn't it amazing that we do that to God? That we say, give me free will, let me kick you out, but then I expect you to never let the consequences of my kicking you out affect me. Daniel says here, we've sinned, us. And yet Daniel is one of, hear this, the few men of the Old Testament of whom no sin is recorded. Now, that's not saying he wasn't a sinner, don't get me wrong, but that means he was like Job. He was pretty much blameless in most of his ways. How many know if the Bible was written about, if I was in a book of the Bible, there'd be a lot of sin. David would look really good compared to me. But guess what? He identified himself with sinners. He didn't say you people, he said we, us. Here, however, he identifies himself as with his sinful brothers and sisters, and Jewish sisters and brothers. I want to read three verses to you that I think really touch me. And it's 2 Chronicles 7:14. You've heard it before, most of you. It says, if my people. Now notice that. It doesn't say if the liberals. It doesn't say if the next president of the United States. It doesn't say if, you know, Donald Trump will just follow God. It doesn't say that. It says, if my people, that's us, who are called by my name, hear this, first thing, will humble themselves. I want to tell you this. You want to know how humble you are? Here's the litmus test right here. Do you pray? If you don't pray, you're not humble. Because if you pray, it shows you need help. Amen? But if you can go through this life without prayer, that shows you're self-sufficient. You're self-reliant. I did it my way. You are Frank Sinatra. But if you're humble and you realize that, as Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing, you then will be a person, a man or woman of what? Prayer. You'll humble yourself. And the next thing is what? Pray and seek my face. You'll seek his face in prayer. And here's the big one. Here's the one we all don't like. And here's the third one. Turn from their wicked ways. Oh, we like to tell everyone else to turn. You know, Obama, you need to turn, right? Everyone else needs to turn. But he doesn't say that. He says, if my people will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then what will happen? Here's what we all want, isn't it? Here's what we all want. But hear this. We all want the end, the last two, but we don't want to do the first three. And how many of those are very conditional? Humble, pray, and then what? Turn. How many know that's what repentance is? Repentance isn't this. We go, oh, I feel so bad. I don't pray. I don't seek God. I feel bad that I'm doing internet pornography. I feel terrible. How many know the Bible says worldly sorrow leads to death, but godly sorrow leads to what? Repentance. You know what repentance means? A change of mind and a change of direction. That means a 180. You're going this way away from God. You turn back to him and say, God, I'm going to do it your way. How many know a lot of us don't repent? We go, oh, I feel bad. Are you going to change? No, but I feel bad about it. How many know that doesn't do a thing, right? I feel bad that I'm a chubbo, but not bad enough to work out. Nobody's going to laugh at that. Okay, all right, there we go. All right, here it is. But here it is. Then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sin. We all want that. And what is it? Heal their land. Our land needs healing. So we need to what? Humble, pray, seek his face. It's all one. Pray and seek his face and turn from our wicked ways. But hear this. If you go, that's nice, Craig. That's great. Real downer sermon. I don't care. I'm not doing it. Then here's the answer for you. James 4:6. God says he opposes or resists the proud. But he gives grace to humble. Anyone out there need grace? Then you need to humble yourself. You need to pray and you need to turn from your wicked ways. Because if you don't, then guess what? God will oppose you. That means he'll put, if you feel frustrated, some of you, I'm not going to ask you because you wouldn't raise your hand anyway because you won't laugh or anything today. But how many know this? Some of you feel frustrated. Oh, I prayed, nothing happens. And you need to ask yourself why. And how many know if you really say, God, why are you not answering my prayer? How many know he'll be happy to answer you? Because of this and this and this, right? But we don't want to wait. We just want to ask what we want. But how many know we have to get right with God before we can just all make all these requests? The best prayer, if you really want to know how to start your prayer right with Psalms 139, verse 23 and 24, which says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, test me, and know my anxious thoughts. Where am I worried? Where am I freaking out? Where am I not trusting you? And then he says, know my wicked, see if there be any wicked way within me. I always ask the Lord, is there anything I'm anxious about? And wait, and God will answer. If you wait, you got to be still for a second and then say, Lord, is there anything in me that's wicked, that's grieving you, quench you? And God will speak. And sometimes it's like, you know, I'm like, oh, Lord, you know, I got to go. But, you know, but if you do that, you'll hear. And then he says, what? Lead me in the way everlasting. Show me how to obey you in these areas. Show me what to do. Amen. You know that verse I was telling you about that the Pharisee and the tax collector? Do you know it says at the end of that verse? It says, those who exalt themselves will be humbled. But those who humble themselves will be exalted. How many like to be exalted by God? Then humble yourself. I love what D.L. Moody says. The branch that bows the lowest before God bears the most fruit. Bow low. Be humble. Say, God, I'm a sinner. And guess what? You know, if you don't know what you've sinned, ask somebody around you. They'll tell you. But you're a sinner, and so am I. And don't be proud of it, but just be real and say, God, help me. I want to sin less. Here's the goal. I want to sin less today than I did yesterday. Amen? And some of us just think, oh, grace, grace, grace. I'm just going to keep on sinning that grace might abound. And what does the Bible say in Romans 6, 1? By no means. No. You appreciate the cross, then now, what did Jesus say? Go and sin no more. If you appreciate my forgiveness, now go and sin no more. That's how you show me you love me. Amen? I'll end with this, Proverbs 28:13. It says, people who conceal, worship team, you can come up now. Proverbs 28:13 says, people who conceal their sins will not prosper. But if they confess and turn from them, they will receive mercy. Did you hear that? If you conceal your sin, you think only God and I know. No one knows, but maybe even God, I hope, doesn't know. But nobody knows. How many know the Bible says everything is laid bare before the eyes of the Lord to whom we must give an account? If we believe that, then let's confess it. The Bible says he who conceals his sin will not prosper, but he who confesses and renounces sin will find mercy. And I tell you again, we need grace, we need mercy, amen? So let's just confess it. And I'm not saying, I want to give you a moment. Can you turn the lights down, somebody? I want to give you a moment here. I know it's going to be a little weird for some of you, but, you know, I'm already weird enough. I think I freaked you out. But just take a moment right now quietly. You don't have to do it out loud so people go, what? But just take a moment to confess quietly some of the sins, and you know the big ones in your life. And just confess them to God. Just humble yourself and say, God, I'm sorry. You know what? Here's the good news. I want to end positive on this. I don't want us to all be like, but here it is. You're a sinner, but God came to die for sinners. All he wants you to do is 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us. But hear this, guys. You know the only sin God won't forgive is the one you don't confess. Amen? So let's take a moment. I'm going to give you about a minute. Maybe a little longer, about a minute, and just confess, just humble yourself, and just tell God some of those things that have been plaguing you, and just ask God, just confess it and say, God, will you help me? Will you lead me in the way everlasting in this area? Will you lead me to walk the right way in this area? Let's take a moment right now, and then I'll close in prayer. Father, we just come to you now humbly, acknowledging that without your Son, Jesus, without his blood, we would be, your throne would not be a throne of mercy or mercy seat for us. But we thank you, Lord, that through the blood of Jesus, that if we'll just confess our sins, as many people say, put it under the blood, if we'll just confess it, you are faithful and true to cover our sin with your precious blood, to wash us as white as snow. And I pray, Lord, that every one of us here would be humble. I pray that none of us would be proud and stiff-necked, as your word says that if a man remains stiff-necked after many rebukes, he'll be broken beyond remedy. I pray, Lord, that we would be humble men and women, that would bow our necks, bow our heads before you. And we would not be stiff-necked. We would not be proud. We would not be stubborn like the mule. But we'd come broken. We'd come humble. I love, as Pastor Chuck said, he said, blessed are the flexible or those who bend, because they shall not be broken. And Lord, I don't want to have to be broken because of my stubbornness and my ignorance. But I want to come humbly. And I pray that you will loose in this church and loose in our land a spirit of repentance, Lord. That we wouldn't blame everyone else. We wouldn't blame our wives. We wouldn't blame our husbands. We wouldn't blame our kids. We would take responsibility like Daniel and say, we have sinned. We have fallen short. And I pray that, Father, that 2 Chronicles 7:14 would be true in our lives. That this message would not make us just feel bad, but it'd motivate us to humble ourselves and pray and seek your face. And as we seek your face, as we cry out, Lord, show me those things that grieve you and quench you, that you, Lord, that would be faithful to show us those wicked ways. And that, Father, we'd humbly say, help me to turn from them. Give me strength. Give us strength to not just feel bad about it and keep doing it, but to walk away from it, to turn around, to repent, to change our mind, and to change direction back to you. Lord, bless your church. And let us see that it's the spirit of repentance that makes Daniel a great man of God that we read about today. And I pray that even though he could have said, hey, it's you guys, it's not me, that's why he's a great man, because he was a humble man. And I pray for that spirit of humility to be upon us, that we could say, we have sinned. We, your people, have sinned. Our country is in its state because we have allowed the PC police to push us into the closet, and the others are coming out, and we have feared man more than you. Amen? And so, God, I ask that as we are humble before you, as we are repentant before you, I pray that it would then rise up not a self-righteousness, but a Holy Ghost boldness to speak the truth in love, to believe that no matter how good a person seems, if they're good without Jesus, it's not good enough. Amen? So, Lord, embolden your people to share the good news in these last days, to tell people, hey, guess what? I know it's going to hurt your feelings, but you're a sinner and you need a Savior. But guess what the good news is? Your Savior loved you so much, he died for your sins. And all you have to do is receive him. And all you have to do is give your life to him, and you can be forgiven and you can be washed clean. Lord, I pray for everyone in this room, anyone here who's maybe overwhelmed and say, Craig, you don't understand. I've gone too far. I've done too much. I've asked forgiveness for this sin 25,000 times. I'm too far gone. I pray that you would just overwhelm them right now with your love, and that your blood would just overwhelm them, that you would just speak to them that you are able to forgive. You are able to clean what is not clean. You are able to wash white what has been filthy. So bless everyone to leave here encouraged that they are sinners, but they are forgiven sinners, and that they will have a heart to say, by grace of God, by His strength, I will sin less today than I did yesterday. Why? Not to be self-righteous, but because we love You, Jesus. So bless Your people, and we thank You in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.